Hey, I'm Sara.
Hey, I'm Trish.
And this is Trying to Win, our podcast about being trial lawyers,
women
in courtrooms,
whatever.
Running a law firm.
Talking.
That's right.
Absolutely.
And we're super excited today to introduce a good friend of mine, Caryn Lee, who is with Narrative. And Caryn has done some work with our firm that will hopefully help us explain how we use personality assessments and that sort of thing to help us manage our team.
Yeah, so we're supposed to stick with our format. Remember, it's the opening statement, what we're going to talk about, the witness examination, where we talk to Caryn and ask questions, and then closing arguments, right? Summarizing everything, and then the verdict, which is where we ask them to rate and review us.
And who
ask
knew
questions,
you'd be the
emails.
Rule follower?
Well, we do have a little bit of a format here. So talking about Caryn, so I was going to tell the experience that we had with her, which is pretty cool. Y'all are friends from a long time ago, right?
Yes. We met because our daughters played competitive soccer together on a travel soccer team. So we traveled all around North Carolina and South Carolina.
Have you
Carolina.
Fully assessed her now?
Yes.
Okay. Good.
Oh, yes.
So Sara had an idea. She said, let's do a team building exercise. Let's bring Caryn in. She does these really cool personality assessments. You know, everybody can take the test. We can identify the type of people that we want to work with us and, you know, get to know our team members a little bit better. So Caryn kind of gave us a rundown of what she would do and explained everything to us. And Sara and I looked at the test, kind of the parameters, what they mean and what you're measuring. And so she and I go, well, let's pick the ideal formula for people we want to hire. And so maybe Caryn can do these assessments when we're interviewing people, and then we can see if they fit our formula, which is, by the way, not what you're supposed to do at all, but we learned that from you later. But anyway, so Sara and I decided we would take the test first. So we had this formula that we picked out together, this custom designer, I don't know, whatever, person, personality. And Sara and I take the test, and both of us flunked. There's no flunking in narrative. Neither one of us had the personality traits, the ideal set that we had developed. And that's when Caryn subsequently explained to us, like, hey, that's not how this works. You don't do that. We don't do that. So anyway, she came in. We did the assessments for our whole team. And then we took, what was that, like a whole day or a half day? And we rented some space and did these really cool exercises where we'd go through all of the different parameters, all of the personality traits.
Traits, subtraits.
Yeah, that you measured. And we even did this thing where you sit on the floor and step forward if you're here and there. And then you kind of got a sampling of where everybody fit on the big five or whatever. I think you had a custom one. Anyway, it was really cool. And the thing that I noticed the most after we finished was that there was a change in the team feeling. Like, everybody felt a little closer, a little bit more comfortable with each other.
In tune.
It changed the chemistry, you know, and it's something, it's almost like therapy.
Yeah, and we're going to get ready to do it again once we can get everybody back in the office, still recording during COVID. So we need to be able to get everybody comfortable with being in a close space together to do something like that again. But we're excited about it.
So have you adequately judged all of us now?
No, there's no judgment.
No judging in narrative.
No judging. And there's no good or bad.
No good or bad.
Yeah. So can I just
tell us how it works?
Comment about that?
Oh, sure. Yeah, absolutely.
So I just want to make sure everybody knows there is no good or bad. Now, when we are looking at a specific job and we are coming up with, okay, so for example, for a litigation lawyer in your firm, we can be kind of specific because you know what success is, right? Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean that whoever takes that assessment, they're never going to match it exactly anyway. But it doesn't mean that they can't perform really well. They can be very successful at that, at being a litigator. But it may, if they're way off, it may be more draining than for someone who matches exactly.
All right. Okay. I guess, first of all, tell us about Narrative and what you do.
Yeah, so I'm a founder of Narrative. For 18 years, I've been working with clients to help them understand how they approach work, what motivates them, and how their teammates approach work and what motivates them. And it helps them to communicate better, understand each other, and get closer, like you said. So we do it through team training, coaching, conflict resolution, and also deciding who will work in that specific job. You know, what's the best target profile.
So have you had people who've taken the assessment and completely decided to change what they were doing in life?
Well, when I coach people and a client brings me in to coach people, you know, it's very confidential and it's not like I'm sharing everything with who they work for. And sometimes they will decide I'm going to do something different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then I do a lot of career coaching as well. That's really rewarding. It's not the main thing I do, but it's really rewarding because it's helping people understand what is going to give them purpose and passion and what it kind of comes naturally to them.
Tell us about the test. Like, what kinds of questions are on there and what are you measuring exactly?
Okay, so we're measuring 5 main traits and there's 23 subtraits, but they all go under these 5. So the 5 are resilience, so how you deal with stress, extroversion.
Not well. No, I'm not.
Extroversion, openness, how much you are open to change and things, and agreeableness, kind of are you going to, when something happens, are you going to think, how's this going to affect the people? Or are you going to think more of kind of the business and the logic? And then conscientiousness is how structured and disciplined and that sort of thing. Now, what we're doing is different than other assessments. We're showing you on a continuum. So that's really important because we're not this or that or a type. This is not a type assessment. It's on a continuum. So there's people on each extreme and there's people all throughout, you know, the middle.
So you just mentioned that this is different from other assessments. How many different types of assessments are there out there?
There's a lot. Some of them come down from oral tradition. Some
are
of
the
them...
ones on Facebook accurate?
I'd have to look at which ones it is.
That's
but
right.
There are, I always say there are a lot that are kind of not worth the paper they're written
yeah.
on. This one, obviously, that I use is very, it's very research-based. It's what psychologists and academics use. It's based on the 5-factor model, which is what they use. So it's a little more detail and more, and I'm not saying the others are bad. Anytime you talk about differences or similarities, you know, it's a good thing. Mm-hmm. But it's just that if you're going to do it for like selection and for really talking to somebody about what they prefer and how they, you know, I think that you need to get into a little detail.
So what kinds of questions are
yeah.
there?
I want some samples. Like, I want to play with them a little bit. Give us some.
They're very simple and straightforward. They're things like, I worry a lot.
Yes.
And you answer on a strongly agree, strongly disagree, neutral, and then, you know, agree. So there's 5 possible answers.
What's your answer?
Do I worry a lot? I don't worry very much. I only worry about the big things, you know, life and death sort of things. The small stuff.
Don't sweat the small
stuff. And as the lawyer, I would go, what do you mean by worry?
It depends.
Right? Like,
yes.
And then my other question is, so I always take them and I always take, when we've done the assessments with you, mm-hmm. I'm answering the question in my work personality, right?
Right.
Versus my at-home personality.
You have more than one personality.
Different. Yeah, it's a little freaky,
multiple.
Right? Yeah. But so do you find that depending on the context within which people are given the assessment tool to take, that their answers may vary a little bit? Not so much so that their personality is completely different, but maybe yeah. just, you know, like, for example, I will share that on every assessment you've ever given me, I mm-hmm. score a 1 on empathy.
Oh, yeah.
On a scale of 0 to 10,
really?
I'm a 1 every single time. But
and
that's
okay.
in my work
right.
personality.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's
yeah.
kind of, particularly for the defense work that we do, not getting wrapped up in the emotion from the other side. So when you're, you know, questioning a witness who's crying about something horrible that's happened to their loved one, being a 1 on empathy is going to help you get through that without kind of adopting that emotion.
Right, right.
But in my personal life, I feel like I have a little bit more than just a 1 on a score of 0
yes.
to 10 on empathy.
Yes.
I mean, I could be wrong about that, but I think I do.
Yeah.
But do you find that to be true?
Yes. Well, first of all, everybody tells me that was hard to take it because it depends on
it's
the situation.
Yeah.
But that's okay because that just means you're going to score in the middle. But if you're extreme, you're going to know that you're extreme, right? And you're going to answer in an extreme way.
Do the results depend on the context within
yes.
which?
Yes. Okay.
Or do you do you instruct the people what the context is that you want them to answer the question in?
Yes. So we are specifically talking about work. And it is based on work questions. It asks about your coworkers and that sort of thing and how you work with them. So it is about work. And I tell them, think about your most recent job. Now, people say that they're different at work and at home. Generally, the research shows that's not really.
Sarah doesn't have multiple
personalities. Yeah. I think you and I know that her personality is her personality, don't you think?
Yeah, well, what you see is what you get.
Look, that's definitely true.
But now, that doesn't mean that some people are different. They mm-hmm. are. But in general, most people, it's and that's why when I talk to people and I go through their scores, they're like, wow, my husband this and my wife that, you know, they really relate to it in a personal way as well. So, but I do ask them to do it based on work.
And so do you ever recommend to people that they take more than one type of assessment?
Well, the first thing is we are really complex, right? And I'm talking right now about a Big Five personality assessment. And I also give people a motivations assessment. I look at it as another layer, right? We are really complex, and we have all kinds of layers. There's intelligence assessments. There's the 360s where you're asking people how you perform, how they think you perform on certain competencies. There's lots of different assessments.
So this is not the sole assessment that you use at Narrative or in your coaching?
Right.
Okay.
Right. All right. Yeah, it depends on the situation as to what I bring in.
So one of the things that we hope then by getting the results of this assessment for members of our team is that it will improve how we all work together. How can we use what you do to make our work lives a little bit more manageable maybe?
Right. And that's the whole point. First of all, when people are score in like on one side of the spectrum and someone else scores on the other, your teammate, that's where there's more room for conflict. Just because you're looking at things from such a different perspective.
You and I should be fighting like hell then.
Well, every once in a while.
Every now and then we have.
But now, to work it out. On the other hand, so that there is room for conflict, but on the other hand, you also complement each other and you own the company, right? Mm-hmm. So you bring different perspectives, and that's a great thing. But it's all about understanding and being aware of that, right? So then what I'm doing with the teams is I'm helping them understand, okay, you're an ideas person. You love the idea.
No, that's me.
Not so.
She's the implementer.
Okay. I was giving you. Ideas person. You're the doer. You're maybe not so good with ideas. You don't want to brainstorm for 2 days in a room. You'd beat your head against the wall. You do love brainstorming if you're
can't
the
get
ideas
anything
person.
Done, though. Yeah.
But you're going to have a hard time implementing. So you need each other as long as you understand that and you assign roles that way. You know, even on a project, oh, she should do that because she's best at that. And then you have people in the middle, they're the translators. And you need those people because, again, the people that can kind of go, I have no idea
what
you're
Scott.
Talking about.
That's totally Scott.
Well, and I was going to say,
right down the middle, yeah.
Your paralegals that you have worked with over time
military.
Have both been implementers.
Very military
both
oriented.
Been, yeah.
Actually, Noelle was in the military.
Very task driven, very get it done. And are responsible for kind of keeping you on task.
I would spin off into the universe otherwise, yes, because I can't. I have a really hard time getting stuff done.
And that's the point is helping them to first be aware and then to turn it around to appreciate what each person brings to the table. And then the last component, which is kind of the hardest, is to stretch to be more like them when you're having an interaction with them. So if I know that you're the ideas person, but I want to talk about a very specific implementation thing, I might put it in the context of, remember that great idea you had and you wanted to do this? Well, I really need to understand something to get that done. I know it's not manipulation. I call it
subtle
manipulation. Yeah, it is.
Sounds like it's me.
I'm really good at that, by the way.
Lawyers would know.
Oh, really? Very good at it.
But I mean, that one sounded like manipulation, but it's about influencing with integrity, I like to call it.
And another way of saying.
But I'm making you feel more comfortable,
yeah.
Right? I'm putting it in context for you of something that
is speaking
is
my language.
Exactly.
It's speaking my language
exactly.
is what it is.
And so what I like to say is once we do that with a team and people start understanding each other better, we get to a better result faster. So it is more productive. It is also, it saves, hurt feelings and it really helps people get along better.
It does. It does. I put a sign on my door that says, I'm not an asshole, I'm an introvert.
She doesn't actually have that.
No, I had it on my door before.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Well, we posted the assessments on our doors, didn't we? Am I crazy? We posted them somewhere. We had them on a chart.
I know somebody did that at our former place, but I don't remember doing that at Lincoln Derr.
Dory's over there nodding her head. I'm right.
I gave you the poster.
We had the poster for a long time. Yeah, that had everybody's drinks. Yeah.
We had that in the
kitchen. It was kind of cool.
For a long time. Yeah.
That's what's wrong with her.
Yeah, but I mean, I'll give you another example.
Just kidding.
And maybe Sara, you've figured this out, but you probably don't like somebody to throw a piece of paper in front of you or walk in your office, throw a piece of paper, read those two paragraphs, tell me what you think. She'll tell me she doesn't mind.
If people tell me what to do, I do the exact opposite, even if it's not what I want to do, because I cannot stand rules. I hate nothing more than being told what to do.
And she doesn't like being interrupted. So anybody walking into her office and handing her something is a problem.
Right.
So, okay, let's talk about you a little bit.
I can. That's fine. Talk about me all you want.
I was giving the example of an introvert. That's all.
Right.
But, you know, you kind of have to learn. I'm an extrovert. So it's easy for me to just stick something. Tell me what you think. But introverts kind of you need to give it to them the day before, send it an email saying, I want to talk to you about this tomorrow. Will you read it? You know, there are things, and it takes effort. It takes effort and intention, being intentional to do this, but it can be really, really worth it.
So tell us a success story that you've had, like a recent one with a team or an individual that really made you feel good about what you were doing.
Well,
besides us, of course.
Yeah. So in October, I actually flew to Nashville to do a leadership training because this was before the surge. It was kind of like we thought it was getting better. So anyway, flew to Nashville, worked with a leadership team. The president and the CFO were pretty new, like within last year. But then they worked with three other people, the operations and sales. And they had been there like 20 or 30 years. So before the session, I had talked to each one of them. I'd gone through their assessments individually. And so I knew, you know, who they were and got some more background from them. And we went in, and it really helped jumpstart them to know each other better. Because, you know, you had those three people who had been there forever. They were used to the culture and everything. And then you have a new president who's leading them. And the CFO is kind of there, like, new, trying to figure things out. So they were like, this is great. I didn't know that about you. And then they say, oh, yeah, that's why you do that, you know. So it was – and, you know, I always have people that are kind of a little bit concerned. And I think on your team there were some people that were concerned.
It's exposing.
Yeah. And
it's vulnerability.
It is. And I usually have people that are a little bit worried about what's going to happen.
Show the real me.
What if my boss finds that out about me and they don't like it?
Yeah. But generally, at the end, a lot of times it's those people that really got the most out of it, you know? Mm-hmm.
So how does this, there's so much focus in law firms today and bar associations about lawyer well-being and stress management. How can these types of assessments kind of help us in the law firm setting to make sure that our teams are doing okay with we have pretty stressful jobs. We have sometimes when we're in trial where we're working, you know, 15, 16, 18 hours a day. So how can we use these things to help us with that?
Yeah, so I think the first thing is to understand where people are, right? When you score a certain way, like as an introvert or as worrying a lot, you know, that resilience piece, then being aware of like your teammates that do take on a lot of worry and stress, being concerned about them and making sure that you have strategies to help them, right? And not to overload them as much. And then there's sociable people on the high end of extroversion. There's less sociable people. But, being social is one of those things that's really good for you. But you don't want to force it on people too much either, because it's good for them to have that time to recharge. So it's really understanding and then helping with those strategies. A specific example on resilience is that everybody, whether you're a calm and cool, you're high on resilience, or whether you're that worrier and can get angry and think about all the things that can go bad in a situation, no matter where you are on the spectrum, we all have stress. And we all need to try to mitigate it, relieve it, like through exercise, mindfulness, meditation, those strategies to help with that.
And so for lawyers in particular, and since we're a litigation firm, litigators in particular, tell us what some of the personality traits we carry as a general rule that might not be the most healthy and that we probably need to be aware of so that we can make sure that we're taking care of ourselves. And then the flip side, the things that are really good for us.
Okay, so again, there's no good or bad.
Challenging versus not challenging.
And that thing, the other thing I wanted to say is that we all can choose how we behave in a certain situation, right? So even if I'm an introvert and I need to go into a room of all new people, I can say, I can do this. I can get out there and I'm gonna talk to 10 people, you know, and you can make yourself do it. Now, you can't make yourself do it every day, probably. It would just be exhausting and difficult. Anyway, that's one thing, is you can behave anywhere on the spectrum. There's also the strategies, like I said, with most. So let's talk about litigators. I would think that litigators in general are going to be less empathetic in general. They're going to be on the lower side of agreeableness. Now, again, this is not all of them. And you might want some that are higher, depending on what niche they have. Right?
Like a mediator. You want them to be, like, they're maybe agreeable, they're coming in the middle.
Right, they may need to be in the middle, right.
The people that help us resolve.
But the litigators do, you know, doing that more assertive things, then they probably, the people that are low on agreeableness, that are less empathetic, more think people can take care of themselves, you know, maybe are a little skeptical. Those people, I would think, are kind of naturally going to gravitate to litigation, potentially. Mm-hmm. Maybe people that are more resilient, more calm, cool.
But not necessarily. Because it all depends.
Yeah, it
right?
does.
Exactly.
It all depends. I was going to say, like, I'm the biggest warrior wart in the world, and I'm introverted.
Right.
How is it that I'm able to go into court? I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah, but when you're not litigating, you're in your office with the door closed more?
With my head up. Head down, yeah.
So, you know, you can go do that and you have the energy to do it, but you wouldn't want to be in court all day, every day, right?
I've done it. Well, I actually think you
can do it.
I can. I've had to. You don't have a choice. But I think for me, at least as a huge introvert, like I am on the, if I do like, what should your job be? It comes back like rocket science or something, you know, radiology, sit in a dark room by yourself all day. Mm-hmm. But I think talking about other people in the courtroom, telling somebody else's story is way more comfortable to me than talking about, like, my internal stuff, you know, what's going on here. Yeah. So I think for me, that's why I can do it. Now I will tell you, I shed more than one set of tears trying to be able to public speak. I remember getting called on in my Civ Pro class. You know, they call on these, what was that thing called?
Socratic method?
Yeah, that's it.
The teaching method in law school?
The basis of the entire law system. That. I remember getting called on, and I couldn't answer. I just froze up and cried. Mm-hmm. And my teacher called me to her office afterwards, because that was a big deal. And there's like 200 people in my class, too. I did it all in front of everybody. And I go to her office. I'm still crying. And she's like, well, what kind of lawyer do you want to be? I'm like, a trial lawyer. She's like, well, we might want to talk about contracts. But at any rate, I overcame it somehow.
Yeah. Well, and the other thing is, remember, there's more to us than just personality. We have all these layers. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, drive is a very strong trait. And so you have other traits that do match being a litigator, right? And that can override a lot of other things. You know, if you have lots of ideas and stuff, that can be so motivating that you can be really gregarious when you want to talk about your ideas. Yeah, and it could be about motivations. There's so many things that kind of, it's a hodgepodge of things that are the reasons why we do what we do.
Yeah, it is kind of funny. I mean, I didn't make the trial team in law school. I mean, go figure, right?
Wow.
I mean, yeah, I didn't make the trial team. Yeah. I absolutely froze up on the audition to make the trial team.
I can't believe that. You're so extroverted,
crazy?
Though. I mean,
I know,
just
and I still,
the antithesis
I can't
of what
explain,
you are.
I can't explain it. But So not only are we trial lawyers, but we're female business owners. We know a lot of successful women in the city where our practice is focused, which is Charlotte, North Carolina, mm-hmm. including you, Caryn. So in your work, have you found particular traits that successful women in business have across the board? Like, is there something that is consistent in that group?
If women and men were that different, then we would have different
assessment tools.
We would have different formulas.
I love that answer.
That's a great
cool.
answer.
But I'm going to tell you a little bit more. I'm going to answer your question, though, a little. But
you're right.
But
you're
reality
right. You will
is
answer the question.
Objection.
But reality is that if the formulas, if the analysis was that way off, then we would have two separate tests with different formulas scoring men and women. So to try to make it, you know,
so we have gender equality in testing.
Oranges and apples.
Yeah. Nice.
Now, there are some that are a little different, but not enough to have separate tests. Okay, but I will say there are specific things I can say about that. One is conscientiousness, which is about drive and self-discipline and organization and perfectionism. The higher you are on that in general for the corporate world, like corporate business, that the research does show that the higher you are on that, the more easy it is to be successful in the corporate world. Again, though, it's all about your definition of success. You know, if your definition of success is if it's more like in the art world, or it would be the opposite, right? So I would say, though, in the corporate world, women need to have that higher conscientiousness. But men do, too. But some, they tend to get away with not as much.
Having less because they're balanced out by some other trait.
And then
I bet they're not empathetic either.
And then the other thing I see is in the corporate world, and specifically probably for lawyers, is that assertiveness for litigators probably is being more assertive. Confidence is one of the subtraits, and having higher confidence kind of on, you know, not necessarily thinking about what everybody else thinks, but what you think is what you go with.
Mm-hmm.
I think those are some of the ones that I see successful women in the business world having.
And so you...
But that doesn't mean that someone that is opposite can't. It's more a natural thing.
And it's so funny because I kind of put you in that kind of more... I mean, some of your outside interests are very mm-hmm. focused on crafts and, you know, art stuff. So mm-hmm. where do you... Well, and if you don't want to tell, we can edit this part.
She is an artist.
Yeah,
she is an artist.
I mean,
it,
so wait, do you find that you kind of meet that definition that you are a little less on the conscientiousness side because of your artsy kind of side, or do you have it all?
You know, I think it's a combination. But it clearly, you know, you can say, here's this person that wouldn't really fit in the corporate world. Really artsy, you know, you can say those, they, it's clear to me when I meet them where they are in general. However, I mean, I have to talk to them quite a while to make sure, you know, and I don't want to, that's part of the reason we don't like type tests, just saying, oh, they're a D or they're an I. It's just so simple, and it's too simple because we are not simple people, you know, people are not simple.
Mm-hmm.
But there definitely are clear, especially on the extremes, there are clear, you know, artistic versus kind of corporate-minded.
Yeah. So how has COVID impacted people in terms of the different personality traits? And,
do they,
you
change?
Know, as business owners, we've struggled with how to manage our people, first of all, completely remotely, because we were pretty much remote when this all started a little over a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've got some people who have come back to the office. We have other people who are kind of in and out, but aren't there consistently.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to manage all of those different personalities in terms of how they're dealing with COVID
mm-hmm.
Has been interesting to say
yeah.
the least.
Yeah.
But what have you found in terms of the impacts of the different traits and how people are managing with COVID?
Right. I think for sure resilience is one of the ones that stands out, because the people that worry and think of all the things that can go wrong, there's a lot of things to think about going wrong, right? And so they can dwell on that. They can, and it can be difficult. And it can have an effect on your mental health, you know? I think resilience is one, this issue of risk taking, right? Who there's people on that spectrum, right? That there's, you see the people that COVID, you know, I'm sure I won't get it, you know,
like and South Carolina, like
maybe that is too optimistic. Right. And then on the other extreme, you have people that, you know, are afraid to go to the grocery store or sit outside, you know, and then you've got people in between that are kind of a little, maybe on one occasion they'll be fine, but the other occasion they're like, don't, you know. So all these people, we're working with them, right? And we have to make sure that we understand and that we say, it's okay. It's okay if they're like, that doesn't mean I have to do that.
Right.
And I think that's been tough, though, for people, because you hear people talking about, like, can you believe that blah, 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 or, you know?
Yeah.
It's a tendency to think about if they're not doing it like you're doing it, that they're wrong or, you know. Well, so I think resilience is one of them.
Yeah, we're so accustomed to being so collaborative. So everything, every case we have in the office has a team associated with it. And to not have a member of the team in the office, if you're in the office, adds a layer of complexity to that communication and that collaboration that we, you know, right now are really having to focus on, because early on, nobody was in the office. And so we were kind of all communicating in the same way, jumping on Zoom calls, texting, whatever. And now we've got some people who are in the office and some people who aren't in the office. And so we're really having to focus now on how to manage that collaboration and how to make sure that we're communicating well with all of the members of our team.
Yeah, so that's one of the things, is that it is harder to manage. It's harder manage. And we have to make sure that we are thinking about those things. Because I talked to one prospective client about, they're like, oh, we announced permanently that we were going remote about 2 months after the pandemic started. And, oh, everybody's fine. And I'm like, I think maybe we should survey them and see if everybody's fine. Because you actually have to do more for employees and communicate more. So one of the, you know, one of my messages is always communicate, because you don't know. You cannot assume that people are doing okay.
Yeah, yeah. It's truly a very interesting time. I know you have a daughter who just graduated college. I have a daughter who just graduated college, first job out of college, and they've never met their supervisors face to face. I mean, you want to talk about crazy, how to manage that communication. I mean, there's just all sorts of stuff that should keep you busy for at least
several years.
I know.
Until the next pandemic is.
This remote work is really a big cultural change, you know.
So last big question, I think, and then we'll wrap it up. Are there any specific tips, tools, or resources that you would recommend to lawyers that would help them avoid, I think we use the term burnout a lot, but the amount of stress that we deal with on a regular basis is pretty intense. So anything to help them manage that. And again, you're going to tell me it depends. Again, I know you are, but that's okay.
I'm going to tell them to take the narrative big five.
There you go.
Conversation with me.
Well done, Karen. So, well done.
I think I'm going to try to do a wrap up and see if I can accurately reflect what I've heard today. I think what I'm hearing is, number one, know thyself. Know why you do what you do, what you're doing, why you're doing it. Understand yourself. You know, you said that some of the people that are most resistant to it learn the most, and there's a reason for that, right? They don't want to know, and then they learn. So know thyself. Number two, know thy neighbor, right? If you can understand the people that you work on teams with and what makes them tick, then you can work better together more collaboratively without getting offended and trying to speak their language, to use the words that we were talking about earlier. And then the last thing I want to know, can we get our opposing counsel to take these tests?
Ooh.
Wouldn't that be great?
That would be super cool.
That would be so much fun. I wonder if we could trick them into it.
I don't know.
I'm not settling this case until you take this test.
That's right.
I will tell you that having your clients take it would be really good.
Ooh, that's
because
interesting
then
too,
you would
it?
Know how, really a lot quicker. You always figure it out eventually, but you know really quickly how to work with them.
Awesome.
That is really interesting.
Dory, are you taking notes over there?
We're gonna have a conversation offline about that. That is a super, super interesting idea. Wow, I hadn't even thought about that. Awesome. All right.
So well, it's a wrap.
I think so. I think you just did our closing argument right there.
I think
there.
I did. Was I right?
Yeah. That's right.
Great. I couldn't
All
remember.
We need is to wrap it up with the verdict. Yes. So we need everybody to download, subscribe, listen.
All our listener needs to
comment needs to or subscribe. Send us emails at trying to win
@LincolnDerr.com.
trying to win@LincolnDerr.com. There you go. Visit us on Facebook.
Oh, yeah, Facebook. And there's all kinds of stuff.
LinkedIn. And
there's a Facebook.
And on our website.
Dory has gone nuts on this thing. I don't know. We're all over the place.
All righty.
That's a wrap.
See you next time.